Hello, I'm Dr. Shay Bess. I'm a board certified orthopedic surgeon as well as a spine surgeon with the Rocky Mountain Scoliosis and Spine Clinic on the campus of Presbyterian St. Luke's Medical Center. I'm here today to speak about physical examination procedures that physical therapists can use in determining whether to refer a patient to a spine specialist. These procedures can be broken down into 8 categories: posture, range of motion, skin, gait, motor strength, sensory conditions, reflexes, and range of motion of the extremities. In assessing posture, we look for normal lordosis of C1 through C7 to be approximately 20 to 40 degrees. Any condition of torticollis, commonly known as wry neck, should be noted. In the thoracolumbar region, normal kyphosis should be between T5 and T7, and again should be roughly between 20 and 40 degrees. And then lordosis of the lumbar spine should be approximately 40 to 60 degrees. We also look for any rib prominence, including a gibbous deformity on Adam's forward bend, as well as vertebral rotation, and also check the spine with a scoliometer to check for thoracic or lumbar prominences. Flat back deformity, or a loss of normal lordosis in the lumbar spine, is also a potential indicator of problems. Next, we perform tests on the range of motion of the spine and the extremities. In the cervical region, we test for spurlings, or creation of extremity pain, by extending the neck and rotating the chin toward the affected extremity. This is an indicator of nerve root compression. And we also ascertain any sternocleidomastoid or trapezial pain, including any soft tissue or bony anomalies. Then turning to the thoracolumbar region, we check for flexion pain, which is an indicator of disc-related problems, as well as extension pain, which may show us facet-related problems. After checking for range of motion in the lumbar spine, we then turn to evaluation of the skin. Scars can denote problems including previous surgery as well as previous trauma. Hairy patches and skin dimpling may also indicate underlying bony or neurologic anomalies. A simple gait analysis can also uncover a spinal condition, namely, is their gait unsteady? This may be due to pain or cervical stenosis.
Trendelenburg gait, or a side-to-side lurch type gait, is due to weakness of the gluteus medius and gluteus minimus.
Motor strength is a good indicator of spinal problems. Motor strength is graded on a scale of 0 to 5. With 0 being no evidence of contractivity of the motor fibers, and 5 being normal strength in that muscle distribution. The cervical and lumbar dermatomes are useful in assessing and locating a corresponding nerve root that may be compressed or affected. Reflexes are tested next, and they are graded on a scale from 0 to 4+. 0 indicates an absence of the reflex, 2 indicates a normal reflex, and 4+ indicates hyperactivity with associated clonus of the lower extremities. Again, the reflexes follow a normal dermatome that corresponds to that respective nerve root. In addition to testing the reflexes of the lower extremities, we also test the reflexes around the umbilicus region. What we want to do is stroke all 4 quadrants that surround the abdomen, and correspondingly, the umbilicus should move toward the stimulus or the area that is being tested. A lack of a reflex or pull away from the region that is being stroked or tested indicates an upper motor neuron lesion and should then be investigated via advanced imaging. Next, the Hoffman test is performed by striking either the volar or dorsal aspects of the middle finger and observing the reflex contraction of the thumb or index finger. A positive Hoffman's reflex indicates presence of an upper motor neuron lesion, most likely emanating from spinal cord compression. We next test the plantar aspects of the foot, evaluating for a Babinski sign. Normally, when stroking the bottom or plantar aspect of the foot, the toes will flex down. However, in the case of a positive Babinski sign, the toes splay upgoing rather than downgoing. Upgoing toes, or a positive Babinski sign indicates a potential upper motor neuron lesion. Lastly, we test ankle clonus, in which case tension on the Achilles ligament will cause a rhythmic contraction, causing the foot to alternate between dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. Again, this most commonly indicates an upper motor neuron lesion. Next, we test for nerve tension signs. In performing a straight leg raise, if raising the leg and dorsiflexing the foot causes pain that radiates from the back into the leg, it indicates there is a space-occupying lesion impacting the disc, which most commonly is caused by a herniated lumbar disc. In the event there is a contralateral straight leg raise, namely by raising the right leg causes left leg pain, it's indicative of severe compression of the contralateral nerve root. Cervical nerve tension is tested by the spurling sign, or creation of upper extremity pain by extending the neck and rotating the chin toward the affected extremity. This will then cause nerve root pain in that involved extremity. If then by placing the ipsilateral hand onto the head and turning the head to the contralateral shoulder, this relieves the pain. This again indicates that the nerve root is being compressed, and then we turn the head away from the nerve root, which relieves the compression pain. Carpal tunnel or median nerve compression at the wrist and cubital tunnel or ulnar nerve compression at the elbow are assessed with Phalen's and Tenelle's at the wrists and the elbows. Osteoarthritis of the hip is evaluated by internal rotation of the hip. If groin pain is present, then hip osteoarthritis is indicated with internal rotation of the hip. Osteoarthritis of the knee is evaluated for joint line tenderness at the knee. Lastly, a vascular examination is performed by evaluating for the dorsalis pedis and posterior tibial pulses. These are graded from range from 0 to 2. 0 indicates an absence of a pulse, 1 indicates a diminished but palpable pulse, and 2 indicates a normal pulse. Also, as part of the vascular examination, a visual examination should note for hair loss, shiny skin, edema, or toenail changes, all of which are indicative of vascular insufficiency. Spinal conditions are serious and proper assessment is critical. We encourage you to follow this protocol for assessing spinal conditions in your patients. Thank you.